Prior to joining PISA, Dr. Tungize worked as Principal Research Fellow in charge of production and germplasm conservation, Rwanda Agricultural Board, and before this position he worked as plant breeder and plant protectionist, especially for common beans. He has good skills related to agricultural development, both research and extension in Rwanda and East African condition. As a breeder, Dr. Zungize has coordinated different research projects with a specific emphasis in extension delivery to farmers. In this frame, he was the national responsible for implementation, evaluation, and fundraising of the Farmer Free School program at the national level in Rwanda. And from 2011 to 2014, he was coordinating an important development project of about 18 million euros funded by the Belgian Development Agency, the BTC. Today, Dr. John is going to present on appropriate technology for scaling up proven technology for pearl millet and sorghum system in Mali. With that, I'd like to welcome you for your seminar.
Thank you, guys. Good morning, everyone. As Matt said, I'm going to present to you the ongoing activities related to the projects presented by Amet, and also where we just try to look at the different scaling up proven technology approaches, which can be which one is it the appropriate among two we are working on, as I'll present in my preliminary results. May I have next slide? Yes, my presentation will be on mainly on six major points, which are background, objectives, main activities, the two approaches we are proposing, and then I will end up with conclusions. As a background, the overall strategy which on these activities based on the following assumption. If we want to improve millet and sorghum productivity, this will be only possible if farmers are aware of better production technologies, and also they have access to those technologies which will help to improve their productivity. Then several proven technologies, including sustainable soil, water, nutrition, and resource management strategies, have been provided by ICRISATs and research institutions. And these are available in the target regions, which are Mopti and Sikasso. We have defined two main objectives. One is to enhance the knowledge of farmers regarding new sorghum and millet production technologies in these regions. And the second objective will focus on how to facilitate farmers' access to those technologies in order to strengthen the value chain in these areas. Then we have a number of activities related to those objectives. For the objective number one, we have focused our attention on to improve the knowledge of these farmers, where we want to enhance knowledge of farmers and other stakeholders on improved sorghum and millet production methods and practices. The second activity will have been focusing on improving capacity of agricultural advisory services providers. And the third one who will have been focusing on skills and know-how of farmers and farmer cooperatives to get how to implement these technologies. The second main objective is to focus on awareness. If those technologies are available in those areas, but do they really have the, do they know if these technologies are around and also if they are really important for them to increase their production? So, the targeted rural communities on the availability and potential benefits of this new improved sorghum and millet varieties, and also the hybrids, the sorghum hybrids, and their availability and benefits for, of seed treatment, because most of the time they have seeds, even if the seeds are of good quality, but if they have not been treated, some of them are failed to germinate in the rates which is recommended, then you start to have miscommunication with farmers. They start to question the new varieties you are bringing to them because they will not reach the results which have been promised to them. And they, then we talk about the options and potential benefit of integrated cereal and legume cropping systems, which this one, the last one is to help, it has two main objectives. One is to improve soil when you just use the legumes for nitrogen fixation, but also to go against the striker, which will help the moments of the germination. It will be what we can call false alerts, which will make striker germinating, and at the same time it will not be focused on the roots of these legumes, then it will go and reduce the timber, which is the soil of this striker. On the second objective, we have focused on to improve access and the linkages, to make linkages between the actors for improving this productivity. Then, these linkages will be between sorghum and millet value chain actors, who are mainly the input suppliers, but also the people involved in the advisory services, which are mainly the local government and also people who are in charge of agriculture in these two regions. So the National Directorate of Agriculture, which helps to get the sustainability of these actions, because we are there with national or international NGOs for the implementation, but for the sustainability, because the National Agriculture Directorate will stay there for long or there for the country. So if they are in charge of the activities, they will continue to make it without depending on the availability of fund of the project. Then to make this happening, the awareness and also to avail the technologies, we have used two main approaches of technology dissemination, which are farmer field schools and also the demonstration plots. As you see, it can be appropriate in some circumstances, and I'm going to talk about it in the next slide. For the farmer field schools, we have a number of technologies which are proposed to the farmers. The first one is to improve soil fertility and also to go for integrated striker management. For that, we used microdose, and also we used the seed treatment which have been done with Eponstar. And this time we have the control where we did not apply the fertilizers, and also we do not treat seeds to make farmers themselves to have a look at what we are doing, what they have been doing before the intervention of the project, and as they will be following all the times the process, the growth of the crops, they will be requested to make themselves the judgment based on the record they have had. If, let's say, in these plots where they have not applied the pepper, they will compare with this one, and they will see the rates of the germination and the number of seedlings which have been dying along the time because they were vulnerable of the diseases, the seed-borne disease, and also not only the seed-borne, but also those which are in the soil, which can attack easily the young seedlings. Then they have three different rates of microdose, which also are applied in different times for the growing season. For this, we have been able to get the highest rates of production where we have applied microdose 2 grams by the moment of fast weeding, and that was obvious because of, and also they had not only obvious but also it has been interesting for them because they know that they need to apply, they need to weed their field, but at the same time they can also apply fertilizer, and the casual labor which is going to be used at that moment will not be so high and do not cost them, because we go beyond this one, we go to the economic analysis to see which technology will be important for them in terms of costs. And that was applied for both crops, sorghum and millet. And in this case, the case of sorghum, it was not the moment of the first sowing, but the most important fertilizer rate was the moment of sowing. And the beauty of the farmer field school's approach is not coming with preconceived ideas and telling them, please apply this as it has been demonstrated. But it can also vary between locations and where the rate is appropriate according to the location, then farmer can choose that one without any problem, and you will not waste much time to convince them because they have already facts and they will apply. And the most important is to increase the production of any crop you are working on. So in this case, in Kuchala, we had the microdose rates of this, the 2 grams at the moment of sowing, which was most important in terms of production. Then we had also varieties themselves. In this case, they are hybrid. They have their own varieties, which I can call addresses, which are combined with between Fada and Sewa, which are both sorghum hybrids. And in this case, the production rate was very high for Fada, and they were happy to use that variety because of a number of factors which concluded allowed to get the highest production. And their choice was for this. And even beyond the production, we went to the point of comparing. We went to the kernel test, where they are going to compare both varieties and also to get an idea of which one is it the best in terms of test, in terms of what kind of food they want to make from the sorghum varieties. And for millet, Torino was the best in Bankas, Sako, which is in Mopti region, and it has the highest rate of production, and the highest yield, and also they like it because it is not late, and also all qualities related to the food they're making, it's really good for them. So in terms of, because when you want to make the scaling up, you need to make an awareness for a number of people who are, or farmers who are involved, who are going to be the beneficiaries of the technology you want to disseminate. The highest number you get will help you to cover and also to reach that production rate you want to increase in that region. So we will see the results of the number of farmers you can achieve when you compare to the farmer field schools and also the demonstration plot. Because this one can be started by training people who are going to facilitate the extension workers and also who are very close to their colleagues. And since they are very close to their colleagues, they will trust the message delivered by them rather than the extension staff or the research technician who is going to deliver the message. So in terms of the demonstration plot, we have reached this number of farmers, which is around 9,000, while with the extension, the farmer field schools, we have reached more than 42,000, which is very high, almost five times when compared to the other one. Then, in that case, the choice of the region of applying the demonstration plot was not by accident, because this one is applied in the region where farmers are used to to test a number of varieties and to go for the new technologies. This region is a region of cotton, where the people are making this. They have their own organized channel of making extension because they need to grow the cotton. But at the moment they grow, at the same time they grow the cotton, they need to make rotation of their field, on their field, and to propose cereals, which are the sorghum, to be tested in those plots where they want to make the rotation. So the highest yield was with Grinka Iero and with almost 1,200 kilograms in Kuchala, I think, in Kuchala region. So, in conclusion, when we compare when we go for each technology proposed, the integrated and sugar and soil fertility management, we saw that the fertilizer rate was 2 grams after the first feeding, and that has increased the yields. The increase was around 40%, while seed treatment with Aplonstar also increased the production and with around 20% increase compared to the previous way of treating their seeds. Or the one they use, which is not really treated. And among the varieties proposed to them, the Toronto was the best variety in millet, and Pablo and Fada, according to the locations, were the most preferred sorghum hybrids. And the farmer field school approach is the most appropriate for scaling up of the new technologies because of the level of people you can achieve. But not only the people, the number of people you can achieve, and also the way you can allow them to learn easily and to get the reason why they should go for the proposed technology. And remember, those are people who are not really educated. They don't go to, most of them, they don't go to school, and we need to get the appropriate approach for them to allow them to make such the decisions, and which is going to easily allow people to adopt the proposed technologies. And as you can see, it empowers farmers with knowledge and skills and makes them experts in their own field, because they will tell you a number of reasons why they need to choose or to refuse a proposed technology. And then they get the ability to make critical and informed decisions. And yes, the way you sensitize them is to allow them to think and to get the way they can make a proposal to solve their own problems. While the demonstration plot approach is mostly applied, as I said, on farmers who are really already familiar with the extension system. This is what we have done so far, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, John. So with this, I think we can open the floor for questions. I will ask first for maybe the director if you have just general comments before we move to the questions.
Thank you, giving us a summary of what you've been doing on this project, a very important project, because those are the two major crops that we're trying to promote or trying to disseminate to the end users. So I think we need to all see where we can still fit in, because there's an extension for about 2 years at the end of this project. So to see whether there's inputs you can give in to get more impact. One general comment, I would suggest that all of us should share our presentations among ourselves to get some inputs, because you can only improve what you're doing if other people look at what you're doing and give suggestions. I saw some few editing there, but I'm sure if John, you have shared this with some of your colleagues, they will pick it. Just a typo, somebody else can pick it. At least maybe I make sure that for the next seminars you get copies of the presentation so that you can just make some quick hits. Is it for hi, can you hear us? Oh, we cannot hear you.
Hello?
Thank you for joining, but you can send something.
Hi, Tabo.
How are you?
I'm fine, I can hear you.
Okay, did you see the presentation?
I missed part of it.
Okay, thanks. So that's one comment. But John, just two quick ones before the police can come in. I think you will be able to give what fertilizer you're using. I think you're talking about 2 grams before and first at the first week. So you tell us what's the fertilizer you're using, what's the formula. And the second general question also, you said there are two approaches, farmer feed school and demonstration plots. And with the farmer feed school, you reached about 49,000 farmers. And with the demonstration, you reached about 9,000. Now, I think it's good to also tell us, why do you think there's that much difference? What is so positive about the farmer feed school, and what are the constraints? Also, well, we know what people say about farmer feed school. There are some problems with that. But it seems to be working for you so well. What really works so well for you? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Maybe before you provide an answer, we have a question on the screen here. Thanks for the presentation. The results sound like an impact assessment study. How did you arrive at the conclusion that the farmer facebook is the most appropriate method for scaling up? Any evidence to support that? I'm taking this question because the person may leave before we go to the
table.
I think they are almost the same as the one you just. First of all, the facts, I think I'll show them that I can go back to the presentation if you allow me. I said with the former fit schools, you are easily getting a high number of people you are targeting. In the same region, in the region where you want to propose the new technologies, you need to talk to, or you need to avail the information to the highest number of people. That's one. Second, getting the highest number may not be the sufficient way of passing your message only, because you are not very sure if they have heard and they know what you're proposing. But the most important is you allow them to come each week or one time for 2 weeks to follow the crop and to observe and observe the changes and to compare the technologies, including what they have been doing themselves. Then they are the one to make notes and to know how many seedlings do I have in this plot, small plot. They will count. Second, for that counting, some are going to die because the way you treat them, the practice is not appropriate. And the other one are not going to die because you are taking care of them properly. For that one, they will make their own conclusion that ours are dying because we do not treat seeds. That's one. Second, if this one is that one, I will just make it short. At the end of at the moment of harvesting, you will harvest. They are the one to harvest. After harvesting, they are going to know they are going to compare. In this first plot where I have applied the new technologies, I got 100. In the other one, I got 60 or 50. The rest will be there. Then for them, they know they want to get the highest, and if they can apply the same rate of seeds and harvest higher in one plot, then there is a reason. That's they want to make that conclusion. In one word, they want to make conclusion of changes between what you are proposing to them and what they have been doing before. If you compare to the demonstration plot, they will look at maybe the crop, which is really very beautiful to see compared to them, to what they have, the greenish, and also the level of growth. But most of the times, the one to benefit on that one, or the one to believe on what you are proposing to them, are those really who have been used to that system and not newly people who are coming to see what you are proposing to them. Because they are getting the message from either essential people or technicians, but it is not something which is taught by their colleagues, their farmers who are living in the same condition as them, who are convincing them. Because if somebody coming from very far is convincing you, and sometimes also living in the different classes, they will believe difficulty, or sometimes they are just reluctant to accept what you are proposing to them. While when they are convinced by their fellows, it's easy.
Thank you, John.
He was asking about the negative thing which is related to farming or the disadvantages related to farming fish. Sorry?
No, I think that's okay. I think that's the whole thing.
Okay.
So before maybe we take the question from Anthony, we take two questions in the room here, and then we get back to Anthony. Two questions in the room, in front of me, on my right side, Dr. Zumore, and then please introduce yourself to our colleague and
Robert Zumore from Southwest Africa. Thank you, John, for this nice presentation. I think this is an important Arctic project, and your title says it very well. It's about upskill. I think what could have helped in showing the differences between the two approaches, I mean the father field schools as compared to the demonstration plot, would have been to really focus on the theory of change that you develop around the two approaches. The theory of change is about how do you go from your different experimental plots up to the upscaling. How do you go from this demonstration to the different numbers you show? And this would have really helped you to have some sort of indicators that you will follow across the whole process. And as I said, if we had a chance to see your presentation, I would have really helped you in that sense. We at CITAC, we have worked a lot on those theory of change across our processes, and it is really helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Zumore. We take a question of Dr.
My name is Ipolit Afayong from IT Research. Thank you, John, for your presentation. Any uptake specialist, technology uptake specialist, will be very excited when you see that data. Because it's really appealing, it's attractive. But I think that there are some small things that are missing, and then to make the presentation very, very good. The first thing I would like to say is when we want to compare pharmaceutical and demonstration, I think that there are some indicators that we need to use really to compare both. Because when we want to do upscaling, the most important thing also is the cost. At which cost we reach that number of people using pharmaceutical and demonstration approach. And I try to calculate quickly. When I saw the number of TOT that you reach, I tried to divide the number of people that you reach by using pharmacy school. I divided the number of people reached by the number of people that was trained to upscale the technology, and then you see that it's just one. 11 people per trainer of trainers, just 11. And I think that this is very small. And if we add to that the fact that we don't know exactly the cost of how much it costs to reach one farmer using farmer fiscal and the other methodology. Those are things that can help us to understand very well the strength of one methodology compared to others. Because in the literature, it is clear, everybody will tell you that pharmacies will be very costly. And many people are going they are trying to avoid using farmers discount. But I think that for this type of project and what we are doing as well in ground-up upscaling, I think that a combination of a both approach using farmer fee school at a level that can help her to increase the offtake and combining that with the demonstration may be very useful approach. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert and Hippolyte. So, John, you may take the two questions. So, I think the first is about the tier loan change, and then the second one about the cost.
Can I suggest? I think if there are only kind of suggestions, I think we just go on and we need for more people to ask, because there's no need for him to react to. So, if there's a specific question, then you can answer. But I think it's just an idea, and then I would suggest that later on there could be some individual discussion. You can see people and see like what he's saying, how to calculate this, so that we can maximize the time. All these two, I think they're good suggestions. So they open up for them.
Okay, so do we take the question from Anthony that you can see on the screen, and then we take more questions from John, I love on-farm data, but you must present some statistics to support your conclusion. Even some standard development in
deviation,
improve the graph and label axis basic stuff. Have you other data on the farm system, economic of intervention, potential impacts at the farm level, climate risk implication?
It's an important question, but in terms of statistics, those graphs I think are part of the statistics. And in terms of,
he wants the standard errors. So I think that we can do that.
Yes, it's ongoing. We will work on that. The question or the the comment is valid. For the impacts related to the impact made to the farmers, we are almost there because we have made a study which is ongoing, no, not really ongoing. We are making the reports that has been collected by Felix, and we have all data, but data were not really, the report was not ready for the moment of this presentation, and I could not include this one, but Felix will make it, and it is more. It's going to be more even comprehensive. And we went even to the level of looking at the gender aspect, which was done also, which was also coordinated by Jumaya. So those two reports are being presented very soon. So we are concerned by those concerns raised by Peter Pass. Anthony, sorry. I will not present it then now.
Thank you very much. Andre and then Edmund and behind.
Good morning. My name is Andre Neka from Research Assistant at APRESET. Thank you very much for your presentation, John. I have a question. Do you have any explanation for the differences in the yield in different regions? There can be maybe soil, climate, and others. And based on those different explanations, you add in your different approaches to improve production, other agricultural practices. Maybe in those regions where the yield were very low, considering other agricultural practices, so as to contribute to the upscaling of those kind of practices.
You're my boss.
No, next question.
I'm Edmund, and John, thank you for the presentation. John, thank you for the presentation.
So I'm a bit concerned about appropriateness. I mean, for me, it's not a matter of appropriateness, But it may be, I mean, the former field school may work because of some underground condition. So I think this study is not really the question is more in terms of contribution, may gain more insight by comparing those two approaches. You see, you have the demonstration, and then you have the front of this group, you have a certain number of indicators. It can be time, it can be budget. Depending on the budget you have, you will not go for front of this group or demonstration form. As people in the rally said, the front of this group is very costly. So if you don't have a certain amount of money, you may not go for that one. And it's also, you know, front of this group is really time demanding, depending on the time frame of the project. So I think giving those contextual descriptions will give more insight to your study. And also, you know, external development may also play a role when we are talking about this approach way. It may work because of external development. It may work because of the people you engage in the form of the school, basically the expertise, the skill. And if you have farmers a lot, okay, you can go for farmers this school. But if you engage also external extensions, you may see that they already are used to this kind of way. And then instead of wasting money and time to go for the farmers this school, we will never go for demonstrations or demonstration products. So I think given this contextual background will help to better assess. And I may not complete about saying that this approach is appropriate, but it can work because of this.
They are not trying to face something, because there are some comments which may lead people to get misunderstanding. There are some conditions you need to reach or to get to have before making comparison. You are talking about which kind of motivation or which kind of facility I may have. Let's say one of people do not have, he doesn't have sufficient funds, then he will go for this one. But it's like other business. Anything or any activity need to get a course of it. But the most important is, what kind of results am I generating? If I don't invest enough, or if I'm investing, it's time demanding, as you say, it's even costly. But who do I want? And again, I may have means, but not invest in the appropriate approach. So the information should be there. It's like you want to buy a car, but you don't have means or enough money to get this type of car, but you know that this type of car is the one appropriate way you are going to use it, or for the set of work you're going to work with. So if in the conditions you have means, sufficient means, what are you going to use as an approach? And maybe you are right, I did not talk about the when Tabo was raising the question of the disadvantages of one or the other approach. I should focus on that to convince or to help you to understand better than leaving you at the level of just showing the rate of people, the number of people who have reached. But if you want to get the sustainability, and if you want to get your technology to be taken by end users, you need to invest. It's like paying workers to get a number of activities being conducted on the ground. So all of those are conditions to be satisfied before getting or before taking one of the approaches. And at the end of the day, if you look at the results and also the sustainability, the results include also the sustainability, then you decide for what kind of approach you should go for. I did not say it is only the one you can use, but in the same conditions, which one is it helping us to get the highest results? Let's go for us.
Yeah. So, thank you. I also joined my colleagues to congratulate you on this important presentation. My name is Rano from EFISA. I have just one question. If I can go to the presentation slide on the first draft. This is in fact related to what was asked by Anthony and also by Andre. I just want to, I want you to tell us why is the difference between this upscaling strategy in different, if you go to the first graph, the upscaling strategy in different villages. Because if you look at, for example, Bariangara and Bankas, it's totally opposite. When one is higher, the other one is lower. When one is higher, the other one is lower. I think there is an important evidence to show there, apart from the statistics that should be in fact presented. So, could you tell us this graph? What does it imply in different villages or in different agroecologies if there's any difference?
So, please answer.
Yes, it would be the same. I think for the first question raised by Andre was to know why the same technology, the same varieties will create different yields in those different regions. If I go to again to the question raised by Birhanu, this is, I think I have commented or I made some comments on this when I was presenting. The difference between the regions, it's the only one response or the only one interesting comment on this is don't come with a solution which is going to be applied for all. Let people test themselves and make their own decision because conditions where you're going to may be different. It's the yield is not the same for all. It is not continuous if compared to the different locations because of different conditions in which some of the places the level of rain is totally different. Some of the regions the fertilizer the soil is not fertile as it is in others, and also the ecological conditions in those regions are not exactly the same. So if you have one location which is getting the high yields in one technology, then it is their choice. So you are not imposing them, and it will help you even to convince them easily without much effort. And it may vary to the other one, and then want to make those decisions according to the fact they have in front of them.
So, you know,
I think what colleagues are saying, and also I think you gave the explanation of that the conditions vary from one location to another. What they are also saying is that if you have information on rainfall, for example, for this particular set of data, Bandiagara, Bankas, or then you may even give the rainfall. I mean, that's what Andre was saying. What is the rainfall for that particular period when this work was done, isn't it? And then soil,
yeah,
and all this stuff, they can help you, the civil groups, they can help you to even maybe get some kind of a graph,
yeah,
that will show all these different conditions, like agronomic conditions, soil conditions, and also the,
yeah,
you can put some graphs together for him.
So my question was related to that, giving some information about those and also being able to, for each of those regions, identify why, what's the specific reason of yield loan or the difference in yield compared to the other, and also identify what kind of practice can be used to be able to improve that. That was the main, I mean, that was the idea
for
the
It's
all
about the background information.
Okay. So let's
talk. We have a conversation from Accra and then the CDB. I'm coming to you, Accra, CDB, and Yeah, I want to acknowledge the presence of that one from ABRDC. Thank you very much for joining. We expect you questions from you.
Someone else.
Oh, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. I think this was just close to the microphone.
Thank you for your presentation. My name is Abubakar Ture, Sorghum Program Ecclesiastes. I have a small question for you. I would like to find out how you design your demonstration plots. What kind of site you use? First. Second, what's your opinion or how do you see another method used in other countries that are very successful with distribution of a small part to farmers? My second part of the question is what your opinion about seed distribution from small pack to farmer. They test themselves as another approach for selling.
Let's take the question from CDB and answer.
Thank you, John, for your presentation. I think I want to come and again to the very context-specific nature of the farmer field school, which is, I think, triggering a lot of questions like this. You know, you have different resources within even the region of Multi, but then different region between Multi, White, and Skasu. But then you are drawing the same conclusions, which I guess apply to the two regions where the study has been conducted. So, and you also mentioned that the extension system in Java is highly affected by the cotton system. I'm wondering if, I mean, there is any differences in perceptions within the regions, but also between the two regions that may affect the intake of the farmer field school. Thanks.
Next question from Valo.
Thank you, John, for this presentation. I have some questions. The first one is about micro-dosing in Sikasso. It will be good to know your objective, if it's really to reduce the quantity of fertilizer. I'm not sure because of the density in general, Sikasso is very high. And then if you put 2 grams in, you are going to have more than 1100 kg, more than the very common one if you are putting in the one block. So I don't know if it's really beneficial to do microdosing in Sikasso, but if your objective is clear, maybe it can help us to understand. You know, I understand very well. Then the second question is about your recommendation, 2 grams of fertilizer per year, and you say that this is the after the first weeding, you say that it's the most important, and we have 39% advantage compared to farmer practice. Then, I think beyond already that, it depends on the context, it will be good to have by context, depending on the area. But another thing would be to have an idea of farmer practice. When we say farmer practice, most of us, we think that it's without fertilizer. And I think in North Zone, farmer only use microdosing. What is farmer practice in your case? Then we can well understand the results. The last one is, I will let me last one. Thank you.
Thank you, Baba. Let's start with the question from Adarami, who is asking about your opinion concerning the small pack seed distribution strategy.
Although we have distributed seed, but we were not on the side of among the technology I've been talking, we did not try to know if they need a such range of package of seeds. But it is known, and even the one we are doing, even if we are not including among the approaches, the quantity of seeds available to the farmers is the one they can afford, which means we will not bring a bag of 100 kgs to propose to the farmer who is going to use on 1 hectare or less. So it is obvious, better if you want your variety to be taken, your new variety to be taken easily, to avail seeds and to avail them in the quantity which is affordable for them. I don't know if I've responded to your question. The answer is not comparison of the biggest bag of seed and the small one. What you have done, we did not go for that. But if I can go to your question, which is known is farmers will access easily to the new varieties if you propose to them the small packet.
Let me
also, I think I understood the question. Yeah. Microdosing itself is not a technology, and any technology itself. It's a way of getting farmers to get to appreciate the need for fertilizer at a very reduced risk. That's why they're using small quantities. Small packs, more or less the same thing. What he's saying is that can you use also small packs of seeds, maybe 2 kg, maybe 200 grams of seeds of new varieties to get the farmers to grow the varieties? So it's a discrimination approach.
But if you want to propose to them this small amount of seed, how are you going to accept to get to them? And how are we going to talk to them in which forum?
As you do it with demonstrations, it's another approach of demonstration. What you need a whole pack. You can put seed treatment fertilizer, anything, and small quantity and go to the environment to test. If you test it in finance, it's very beneficial for him, he will adopt it. But it's a way also to help you to scale that your technology.
Maybe I did not get you well. Was it a question or a comment?
That I was asking your opinion. That's what I was asking.
Let me bring this like this. I think you may discuss this later after the seminar, because these are two approaches that you both can discuss and see how you can complete. That one coming to you. Are you want this and link with?
My name is Tedmore. I work for the Research Center. So I wanted to follow up on their discussion about distribution of small packs to farmers. We also read that the Research Center is a part of informal variety release, where breeders develop new varieties. But before it is formally released, you want to find out what is the perception of farmers. So you make small quantities and then you distribute, farmers try, and then they can give you feedback whether they like it in terms of whatever characteristics. But I also got one small comment. This presentation, thank you so much, it was a great presentation. But for climate purposes on the graphs, you know, because me, I was wondering, are these grams or are they kgs, like what it also highlighted, it would be good to clearly label. So that by just looking, you know, are we talking of 1,200 grams or 1,200 tons of minor quantity?
Thank you very much. I think you have an opportunity here to discuss with AVRC and then with ADA. They are both working a lot on this seed pack dissemination.
Before we take the final questions, I think we have more questions coming from CDB and Balo.
The question Amadura raises then, or CDB raises, is if I'm not wrong, you want to get clarification among the two approaches and how it has been conducted and why those two approaches getting different yield in those different regions. Am I right? The conclusion have been applied to depending. I don't have only one conclusion point, but the points have been made according to the regions where the tests have been conducted, and also if I go to the two approaches, you mean pharma fiscals and also the demonstration plot, the basics were made according to the background of the regions, where we have a higher chance of convincing people by applying this or the other one. So, and then depending on the background of the region where you are going to apply your new technologies, you may choose one. As I said in my conclusions, I say demonstration plots will be more appropriate if you go to the people who are already familiar to the people coming to them for the extension approaches, which they have already an idea of working with extension workers. And if you come for the second idea, they will easily understand what you mean. Not just saying, this is for just a research institution, but they can come and listen easily and also willing to test themselves in their own farms. The question of Baba related to the microdose, I'm not sure if we understand it the same way, saying that the rate is so high and also we may end up by applying the highest rate of fertilizers if we go for microdose. That was not, I did not get that feedback.
My question was about Sikasso, where plant and city is higher. If you are going to apply microdose in Sikasso, it's possible to have more than 100 pages.
That's what I'm at. Just for clarification, I want to make is I may not go in deep in discussing the importance of microdose. That was maybe the more appropriate person to go for such questions, but what we have got as a result of what we have applied was not showing that because of the density, which is higher in Sikasso compared to Mopti. Remember also the crops are not the same. We did not get that difference, but we can pay attention to that later on. But for the moment, the result we have did not show that. For the second question you raised, if I'm not mistaken, you are talking about the practices applied by farmers in, I think this is the question of knowing if we are applying the package and also if farmers are following what the package related to what you are describing. Am I right?
The farmers are already
Using
microdosing the norm.
Yes. You are talking about the farmers' practices and what we describe as farmer practices. Is it really without fertilizers? In that case, because